Welcome, Brickmaniacs, to a, we're going to do a little bit behind the scenes interview with Dan Siskind. And this is, we're doing this for our magazine, but we're going to post it up here on YouTube as well, just to kind of,
Oh, so I can't change my answer.
No, you can't change your answer. Maybe we can change it. So. Well, let's just get started. Dan, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? Pretty straightforward question.
A little bit. Well, I'm 48 years old. I've been playing with Lego bricks since the early 1970s. That makes me about average age, I think, for the Lego community. I've just never stopped. I've been playing with Lego on and off, mostly on, for my whole life, just about.
What was the first set that you had as a child?
It had three digits. I don't know the actual. Maybe it only had two digits. I don't remember. It was a really old one. It was a white box. It was a styrofoam. I don't remember the name of the set because it was just. I don't even think they had names back then. They didn't have instructions. It was just like a box with bricks, styrofoam box with bricks in it. There was a little tray on top that had like a couple of doors and windows in it. Some wheel sets so you could make a little car. I still remember there was like a blue 4x8 plate in there, some black 2x2 wheel sets.
Someone's going to find out what set that is.
Yeah, it was like number 16 or something. Yeah. I remember it's a white box, and the Lego logo had like multicolored bricks next to it, stacked up next to it.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow, there we go. What was your first mock, my own creation? What was your first mock that you created?
Well, I think I got that box of Legos, started building my own stuff. Right. Obviously copying the pictures off the side of the box, but yeah. Maybe because I'm older than what we have now is the concept of you have to go buy a Lego set and build what the instructions are. Back in the old days, they didn't have that. You just got either an idea book or there was instructions, but they weren't very detailed.
What set stands out to you as something that you really wanted as a kid?
Oh, for sure, the Yellow Castle. The Yellow Castle was my friend. Alex Britt, he had one, and I was super jealous. I got to go over to his house and play with it. And he got it for Christmas, so I asked for it the next year, and maybe even asked for it that year. I don't remember, but I remember asked for it for Christmas or Hanukkah or whatever, and I don't remember. I didn't get it for sure. I got the Galaxy Explorer instead, so to my great disappointment. Although the Galaxy Explorer on its own right was an awesome set, but it was still a lot. My hopes for the Yellow Castle were crushed and forever crushed because it went out shortly after that went out of production and never to be seen again.
Is that perhaps why you started doing so much castle line sets?
You could
capture that child.
Yeah, I missed it. I mean, I remember getting that was like the era of the Yellow Castle had, there was like three sets. And because we were on a budget growing up, I got the little tiny set with like, it was like a little cart or something, and it had like two guys, yeah. Armor cart. And I really wanted the castle because it had knights in it.
That armored cart didn't exactly go with your Galaxy Explorer either.
No, I think I might have gotten that before the Galaxy Explorer. But it was my first like with the actual Lego people. I mean, I think my first set with actual Lego people was that might have been the Coast Guard base, about 1977 or something like that. I don't know. It was a Coast Guard base, maybe definitely late 70s. I'm not sure. Somebody can look that up. Coast Guard Station, I think it's called.
Next question. When did you first get interested in building historic military models?
Oh, geez. I don't know. When I was a kid, my dad was really into naval history. We had all these books around the house, so I was always trying to build ships. And I remember when I was really young, my dad built a Corsair, and I thought that was really cool. He used my sister's. My sister had some sort of blue float plane, and my dad turned it into a Corsair. I remember that, and then I tried to make my own. And I remember I turned our coffee table into I built a superstructure on it and made it into an aircraft carrier. So, yeah.
Superstructure. So
the island of an aircraft carrier.
Right.
So I didn't have to build the whole aircraft carrier because the table was already the right shape. It was long and skinny coffee table, and I turned it into an aircraft carrier.
Very cool.
So I was probably like 8, 7, 6. You know.
So what was between those first few military models? And then the sort of the genesis of Brickmania, how did Brickmania get started?
Well, Brickmania was almost started by accident. I mean, it was building, like military stuff for sure, was just something I did for fun. And I would build tanks. I remember my first tank was built with the parts of the Yellow Bulldozer, which was like, came out like 1980. So I got my first tank tracks. And then my mom discovered I don't know what it was. You can get customer service had a little ad on the back cover of every like instruction book in Lego, and there was like a service pack you could get that had like another 100 tracks. So my mom bought me like three packs of those, and suddenly I had like four tanks. So that was cool.
That's
my
cool.
Mom was awesome.
The track links are what opened up the possibilities for you.
Right, right. I started making tanks. I mean, I made airplanes. I made an F-4 Phantom when I was like 10. F-15s, all that stuff. But they don't look anything like the stuff we build now, of course.
Right. So that eventually just kept going until you started producing instructions for other people?
Right. Well, it wasn't that. I mean, I always built castles. And there was a certain point where, like, before the real World Wide Web started, there was news groups. And there was a Lego news group. And a bunch of people had been talking about building sets and posting occasional pictures. Of course, back then, posting a picture on the internet was actually a difficult challenge. But everybody started this thing, Brick Shelves opened up, and you could post pictures to Brick Shelf. And that's about the time that Brickmania started. I can do this. And I think a whole bunch of technology sort of came together at once. The internet, the idea of project like open source projects like Eldraw happened. So like suddenly we have this drawing tool that we can make our own instructions with, or at least make pictures of Lego stuff and our own Lego models. And then an idea of like, hey, we can actually sell these. So a few people got together on the internet. My contribution, I didn't want to step on anybody's toes, was to make castle stuff, because at the time Lego wasn't making any castle sets. So this was probably 1999. Mid to late 1999.
Mid to late 1999, that's when you actually registered, or Brickmania became official.
Right. I started selling parts on the internet. It's like I needed a domain, and I started posting pictures of all my creations, which at that time had been mostly my childhood stuff. I wasn't all that old at that point, but I had a whole basement full of Lego, and I never took any pictures of any of it, so my own personal collection. So that's what Brickmania started.
And then there was a famous book that you put together that started circulating the internet, or a CD that you put together that started circulating the internet. Or how did that go about?
Well, it actually started that I started making sets, started out with castle sets. I designed four sets that would be the first four Brickmania sets. Okay. The blacksmith shop, a tavern, a mill, and the church. So it was like basically build your own village. None of them were actually military models. They were all like civilian models. The church actually had, it was like a castle. I mean, I was really obsessed with medieval architecture. So I built these houses or whatever, they're buildings, in a completely different scale than Lego. Lego always had this like sort of like toy castle thing. It was really compressed. I was like, let's make the houses the way they really are. And that became the basis for my original castle sets. That was about late 90s, 2000. It took me like two or three years to get all these sets out into production, because back then I get a set done every 6 months or something. In the meantime, people had seen the pictures of my military models and started asking me to build those as well. So,
okay.
So by about 2003, 2002, Brickmania was doing both castle and military stuff, about a half dozen models in each. And it was getting to the point where it was becoming a full-time job. So it's like I decided I was going to back off of that. I didn't need two jobs. I already had a job. Decided to drop out of doing Brickmania and put everything on a CD. 2003, spring of 2003, said, okay, I'm done. Brickmania is no longer a thing. If you didn't get any of my kits, too bad. There wasn't anything really left anyway. And I made instruction CD with all the castle, all the military stuff on it, a couple trains and things like that.
Before we get into the dark years where Brickmania did not exist, I wanted to talk a bit more about that blacksmith shop. For the people who are not familiar, why don't you go over that?
So the first actual Brickmania set, I think it's Brickmania 001, was my blacksmith shop. There's one here. For the people reading, you can't see it, but if you look at anywhere, you can Google this, Lego 3739. That's the official Lego set. It's a copy of my blacksmith shop. So I made 10 of these blacksmith shop using parts that I had purchased at clearance. Basically, how Brickmania started is I was going to Toys R Us, Target, whatever and buying stuff on clearance and going, oh, I can make cool stuff with this. And it got to the point where I had all this leftover stuff that I didn't know what to do with, and they're all brand new parts. Like, well, let's make some sets with it. You know, first I'll sell off the parts I know I don't need at all or trade them away. And then, you know, there was no Bricklink or anything like that back then. So I just made my own website, started selling that off, and then that was one thing I was doing, and then making this blacksmith shop was the first set. So it's remarkably similar process of how everything is made today. Yeah. Not a whole lot has changed. I made a prototype model, made instructions, built it a couple times, made things that changed right. it to make it work better. My original prototype model ended up being too small to have people in the second floor, and I rebuilt it so you could actually have a second floor of the blacksmith shop. Opens up like a, you know, the same sort of Lego houses did when I was growing up. You'd read the idea books or some of these sets, and the houses would open up down the middle or have some other clever way of getting inside. So I just did the same thing. I just did what was sort of ingrained in my head. So my first set was this blacksmith shop, made 10 of them, put them up on eBay thinking they would be there. Put them up on my website, actually. Put one up on eBay, put the other 9 up on my website. And they sold out like a week. Wow. I was pretty surprised.
Wow. So that eventually became an official Lego kit, or its successor became a
right.
Lego kit.
So my old sets I could only make with whatever parts I had, and some of those parts that were in that set were quite rare, and I would have to buy, like, in order to make one blacksmith shop, I'd have to buy like 5 Gungan subsets, like Star Wars sets that came out, like first generation Star Wars sets. Fortunately, they were really cheap because they were on clearance. I could get them for half price because Lego either overproduced or, you know, they made a ton of Star Wars sets, and that one in particular didn't sell very well because why would you want an alien submarine when you could have a TIE fighter or something, you know? So I ended up getting those cheap, but it was very, very difficult to keep that. So I made 2 batches of 10, and I had enough parts to make 4 more because that's how I had pre-orders. Like, 4 people said they wanted that, made 24, announced I was discontinuing it. And immediately, within hours of me announcing I was going to discontinue it, I got a phone call from Brad Justice, who was introduced himself as a vice president from Lego.
Wow.
He was in charge of creating a Lego community organization within the company, because at that point Lego had never interacted with the community at all. Their entire interaction was through their customer service. They didn't, you know, basically they would supply parts if you had a broken part. That was about the extent of it. They had a fictitious Betty Crocker type person named Susan Williams who would answer your email, or answer your letters. You have to write a letter. So no matter where you were, from any part in North America, Susan Williams would always answer your letter. So I had one time I had gotten a set, and I remember as a teenager, and I wrote to Lego and said this piece was injected or whatever. I didn't know how they were made. I said this piece was defective, and they sent me a new one. Susan Williams sent me a new one.
Thanks, Susan.
So Susan Williams is awesome, but she also didn't exist, and there was no Lego.com or anything like that. So they actually created this department. Brad Justice said, hey, I've got this idea. Lego is gonna make sets made by the public, and we want you to be number one. And this is how it's gonna happen. And that's exactly what happened. But so I discontinued my set and got that phone call, and I said, yeah, that sounds like a great idea. And I didn't know that they'd already been working on this, because within hours, I got an email with Lego showing their prototype of their version of my model.
Wow, so that was ready to go.
That was ready to go, and then I put 2 + 2 together, or 1 + whatever, and discovered that Brad Justice was one of the first customers I had. He bought one of the first 10 or so blacksmith shops. So that's how Lego had already done this without my knowledge. They'd already started this whole process. Wow.
It's a good thing you said yes.
Yeah, good for them. Yeah. But it did take a long time. I mean, they'd never done anything like this. They've never worked with an outside not Lego employee designing their stuff.
Yeah, so you were the first non-Lego employee right. to make a custom set.
So, I mean, they sent me a contract that was like, you almost needed a wheelbarrow to lift this thing. It was huge. And I'm sure I'm breaking the contract just by talking about this. So, but yeah, anyway, it was a huge legal document. It took them a long time. And apparently, it didn't take them a long time to make them. It took a long time to make the contract. That was the biggest thing. So, I do know they made at least 20,000 of them. They didn't really have like Lego stores. The only place you could get this was to order it through their catalog, their mail order catalog, which at the time was a lot different than the mail order catalogs we have now, a lot smaller. And they had a few Lego outlet stores. But nowhere, I couldn't go. There was a Lego store at the Mall of America. They didn't have it there.
Wow.
They had like probably a half dozen Lego stores in the country. That was it. But they didn't. At my local store, they didn't have it, which I was kind of sad.
Oh, bummer.
Yeah.
But you eventually got a copy. Or a few.
Yeah, I bought a bunch.
Okay.
I bought a bunch. My mom bought a bunch. I'm glad she did because I parted all mine out to make cool stuff.
You parted out your own kits. That's full circle right there.
Well, I parted out my own kits. And the reason being is, you know, I made the sets based on my interests. And, like, I need more guys. I need more, like, medieval stuff. I need more windows. What a better parts pack than my own stuff. So it had everything I wanted in it.
Oh, man. Okay. Where do we go from here? You had, and so there were some dark years where you were not really involved in producing sets. Dark years for the community, I guess. What were you doing in the meantime?
So I had to make a decision. I ran another business. I ran a record label, and that had been doing that for many years before this Brickmania thing started. And there was a period of time, you know, I was getting invited to go on tours. I was putting out a lot of records. I couldn't do both. And I have, you know, I'm a father. I have, you know, other responsibilities too. So I was like, I have to put something aside. There's just not enough time and day to do everything. And Brickmania was becoming another job. I was like, this is no fun anymore, relatively speaking. And it still was. It was still an awesome thing, but I couldn't no longer justify that being my hobby when all of a sudden I could really realistically work 40 hours or more a week on it. So I said, I'm going to set this aside. I will continue to play, build with Lego on my own, work with the, I was a member of the local train club, the GMLTC at the time, who actually got me into Legoland, which is kind of fun, but another story. But for 2003 on, it's like, I'm done. You get the CD, here's all my instructions. I made 500 CDs, CD-ROMs, figuring 500 would actually be too many, and lo and behold, they sold out in like a few months, but when they were gone, they were gone. I'm done, sayonara, goodbye. I left my website up, but I took all the contact information off the website. So you couldn't even write to me through the website. And just said, here's the Brickmania website. We'll probably never open again, something like that. And thanks. And that was it. I disappeared.
Disappeared
from the public eye. Like I said, I still was involved with the local train club, so I was building, I was still doing things, but just not in the public eye.
So what got you back in?
It was actually an offer to do a book. So a publisher who's pretty famous in the Lego community, actually, they had approached me about doing a Lego military book, instruction book or something. And they were really vague with the parameters of the book, and I never ever did get a decent explanation from the publisher what exactly they were looking for. So that actually fell through, but in the meantime, it kind of brought me back into like, hey, let's look at some of this military stuff that I had previously done. And I started actually working on it and putting some of the models out there on the internet, discovered that there was this thing called Flickr where people were posting military mocks. So I started posting some of my stuff, and that brought people back to me like, oh my God, you're Dan Siskind, you blah, blah, blah. You did this, all these models and stuff back.
Any notable people that contacted you? Maybe of a certain company that we are affiliated with?
No, but I basically went, so I started contacting people, some brands, and saying, I want to do this book, I need some help, can I get some parts? Some people were very receptive, some people were very not, just to put it blunt, they were very like, jerks. Like, no, I don't know who you are, I don't care, and I'm not going to help you, and you know, that kind of thing. So. It was actually going to Brick World, the GMLTC, the train club I was involved with. They went to Brick World, I think it was 2009, Chicago. Maybe it was 2008, I don't know which year. They asked if I wanted to go. I almost didn't, and at the last minute I said, oh sure, why not? I didn't have a hotel room. I slept on the floor of like some of my friend's hotel, you know, their hotel room. But I went there and had a really good time. Met some people. I met Will Chapman. I met a bunch of people.
That's actually what I was getting at. Yeah.
So I met some people, and really what stands out is Will Chapman, who I had talked to just by email a couple of times before, he gave me, I told him I'm making this book, he gave me a gigantic bag full of Marine sergeants and said, here, use these, and if you, you know, I'll lend you these. Of course, he's never asked for them back after all this time, but he basically gave me a gigantic bag of hundreds of dollars worth of figures and said, here, use these, and gave me a big pile of helmets and guns and said, these will help you. And that start basically, at that point, I was like, well, this is for real. I can start working on the book and start making models. And of course, people immediately asked if I'd start selling them. So what I did is, to keep everybody happy, I made an instructions club. Every month, I would put out a new set of instructions. You could subscribe on the internet, and then you would get access to this new set of instructions. And of course, that eventually, within a year, that led to me putting out new sets.
Very cool. And here we are kind of today, right?
Right. Right. So that led to, you know, basically Brickmania, bringing Brickmania back into full swing. So that was probably by end of 2009, Brickmania was back making new sets.
Very cool.
Yeah.
So I understand that you're among the first to document a lot of many different models. You might have been the first to build certain historical models, and along with that, there are different techniques. Do any of those models or techniques stand out to you?
A lot of firsts. Well, yeah, I mean, the internet was new, so we were all posting, like, here, there's all this great stuff that we've done. So nobody had done any military stuff, especially, people probably were, but I was smart enough to take pictures of my models back in the 70s and the 80s. Some of them, anyway. So I made ships. My ships were red because that's all I had. My first big castle was red because I had the most red bricks. So all my mega builds were red. But yeah, I mean, things like using Lego chains, the Technic chains, using those for tracks on like smaller tanks. That, I'm pretty sure I was the first to do that. I was doing anything I possibly could. But one of my roommates was a model builder. And he had all these 1/35th scale models, so it was really easy for me just to go, hey, look, I can build that. You build that tank, I can build it too. And I, you know, the chain link was like, at the time, I was like, that was the coolest thing ever. Why didn't anybody ever think of doing this?
That's cool. So, going back to what you are currently working on, what's your favorite part of designing a kit? Maybe the process hasn't changed a whole lot, but.
It's a little daunting. I mean, the hardest part is actually just getting started because you don't know where to start. You have to do your research, and then you say, okay, I'm going to find my diagrams. And, you know, you can always tell when you first start out, like, I'm going to build this tank. Like, where do you start? You know that you have the capability of creating this thing, but you have to start somewhere. And that's the hardest part, is getting started. I don't know if there's a favorite part. I think it just kind of set. There's a certain point where, like, I'm sick of doing this.
Maybe it's the challenge.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, I am a builder, I'm not a player. I don't play with Lego bricks, I build with Lego bricks. I give my models, completed models, to other people to play with, so.
I have seen you play with Lego before, no. So I've heard you say that your favorite kit is the one that you're working on, but is there one that stands out to you for being particularly challenging to design? Or something that turned out better than you expected?
It happens a lot, actually. There's some things you just don't know where they're going until they're done. So like the castle sets that I was working on, sometimes you didn't really know where, because they're part historical, but the problem that I find with castles is that the pictures and the drawings and stuff that you have, they're all various. They're usually historical interpretations or recreations. So a lot of classic fairy tale castles were actually products of the 17th and 18th century. So you don't really know what these things look like. So you have to do a bunch of research, figure out where you're going to go with it, and then try as best you can to make it historically accurate. That's a challenge. Those are fun to do, but you never really know where they're going. Like the Highland Keep, I did. It has all the cool stuff is on the inside. Never did finish the outside. So, yeah, I don't know. I like the process more than I like the actual, you know.
Sure.
There's many steps involved, I guess.
Do you care to name drop any builders that are doing a good job in the Lego community?
Oh, there's too many to mention.
Too many to mention.
Yeah, I would hate to like point somebody out.
Sure.
I mean, I work with some really talented people. I'll have to say that. And I see, you know, I go to shows, and there's definitely models that really stand out. What I don't like seeing is when like kind of younger, newer people kind of get forced to the periphery. Mm. It's like some of these conventions you go to that there seems to be like this like a hardcore group of people that think they're the God's gift to Lego builders and Lego fans. And in the meantime, there's other cool builders, but they never seem to get the spotlight because it's sort of like a they're not part of the cool crowd or the in crowd or something. So that disappoints me. Hmm. I would think that the building community should be a little bit more inclusive.
Right. I guess to that end, what do you think could be done to create that opportunity for younger builders?
Or not even younger, maybe just newer builders.
Newer builders, yeah.
I don't think, take away incentives that reward that sort of behavior. I see people, a lot of the events, fan events, a full Lego, adult fan events, they get basically insiders to nominate the best of this category, best of that category. And sometimes they pick people that are really like not the best, they're not the fairest, they always pick the same people. And I really think there should be more effort made to broaden the inclusion of new builders, of different builders, and not be so snobby. I mean, quite frankly, there are some events that are invite only, and you have to be a certain level of builder to be involved, and that's a double-edged sword. It spotlights the really good builders. On the other hand, it makes it so unapproachable for the average person.
Hmm. Yeah, maybe that's a part that the other side doesn't see all that, the public doesn't see a whole lot.
But. Well, like one of the disappointing things, I remember going to like seeing pictures of Legoland, never been there, but you go to the Mall of America, they had these gigantic builds, and they're using tens of thousands of bricks, and meanwhile, you couldn't even buy those bricks. Hmm. You could buy, I wanted I remember wanting to get, I'm building a castle myself. I knew exactly how I wanted to build this castle. I needed X number of arch pieces for windows. And the only way to get those arch pieces was to buy like some $100 set. I'd have to go buy 50 of these sets. So every couple of weeks, every payday or whatever, I'd go down and buy a couple of these sets. And then finally, they went out of production before I could finish my castle.
Oh, no.
But that there was like going to see something that was so awesome that the Lego designers built, but you have no hope of being able to build that yourself. Like how in the world could I get 10,000 2x2 tiles? Or just Lego didn't even sell those to the public at the time. And I think that's what a lot of these, it's sort of the same sort of like disconnect when the Lego shows and events are organized by people that are such insiders that they have access to all these parts that the average Joe Schmo public doesn't. And they see that it's the same thing. Like, I'd really love to build it, but I don't have all those parts. I didn't even know where to start. And they really need to work on bridging that gap.
Sure.
Lego has to work on it, and so do the fan events.
That makes sense. I guess maybe speaking of working together with people, any recent product or projects that you'd like to talk about?
Yeah, I mean, on occasion, Brickmania does work with other outside builders. We've had guest builders before, and we just recently did this locomotive kit with Kale Leapheart and Glenn Holland of Brick Model Railroader. I mean, they're established builders, especially Kale's been around for in the community almost as long as I can remember. I mean, that's an older name. Glenn's a little younger. But we get the opportunity to work with other builders outside of necessarily our area of expertise. I've been part of the GMLTC. I'm a fairly competent train builder, but it's not my area of expertise. And when we can work with somebody who is an expert in the field or people who are experts, that's really neat.
So I guess for Brickmania, what's Brickmania working on right now? Maybe bigger projects?
Well, I mean, Brickmania is it's a big organization, and ultimately our goal is to sell kits. We do minifigures, we do accessories, of course, all the stuff that goes with it. But we really are an organization designed around our main product is this sort of Lego set, the same thing that you go buy a set at the store for. We just want to make it one step better. Mm-hmm. The experience all around. You know, we have the white glove Lego sets. Yeah, fancy. yeah, you have to go see. You know, we're not an entry level company to get started in. But to that end, we want to open stores. We want to make really cool displays that will really wow people. So those are things that are happening in the future. And we're also exploring ways to broaden our appeal. I mean, when one of our most basic sets, the Sherman tank, costs $170 retail, it's not entry level. Our Jeeps are $40. We have to work on ways of getting those prices down, and that's another area that we're working on.
So going back, I guess, into the builds. So what is your favorite piece that you like to build with?
My favorite piece.
Changing gears here a little bit.
Yeah, lately it's a bracket.
Yeah.
the various brackets. Both, I think myself and Cody have been swearing by, let's replace everything with brackets because nobody uses them. Lego uses them a ton in all their sets. And you can get them dirt cheap because they're everywhere. And they're such useful changing geometries. They have these, you know, like the up brackets, down brackets, left brackets, right brackets. You know, you can make anything with a bracket. And it, instead of just the traditional studs up, solid bricks building, which is, it's a great technique in its own right, but we can build everything in any angle using brackets. And you have to think in 3D dimensions all the time. It makes it a little harder, but once you get used to the system, you know how they work. So brackets are the key.
Very cool. I guess one last question. Do you have any words of advice for aspiring Lego model makers?
Yeah, don't be disappointed when you know, don't follow trends. But don't be afraid to, like, if you see somebody has a cool technique, use it. Use it, make it better, make it your own. Don't feel like you have to invent something all the time. The community is out there showing off their stuff, borrow it, add to it. It's not like, and then don't say, oh, you can't use my technique, you know, stuff like that. That's ridiculous. Be part of a community. Realize that you are part of a group, you know, that's bigger than yourself, and contribute to it.
Yeah, is that contributing kind of key to that process?
Right, and don't be a snob. Nobody likes a snob, and nobody likes an arrogant builder, too.
Are you an arrogant builder, Dan?
Absolutely not. I firmly believe that anybody can build as good or better than I can. I don't think I have a monopoly on skills in this department.
Very cool. Well, with that, I think that concludes the interview. Yeah, thanks for joining me. Thanks for being 10 feet away from your desk.
Yeah. Thanks for watching this whole thing.
That's a little interview. I guess for more information, check out brickmania.com. Thanks for watching. Cool.